All right, I am over the moon thrilled to announce our next special guest. I have just been learning about Sarah Edmondson this year. There are so many things you need to know about Sarah Edmondson. Sarah is the author of an amazing book that I am currently reading right now. It's called Scarred, the true story of how I escaped NXIVM, the cult that bound my life. So this is a good book. Sarah will have some of these books during the lunchtime where you can go get them signed. I promise you, you will want to read this book. But Sarah does so much more. She's an actress. She, with her amazing husband, Nippy Ames, is the co-host of a podcast called A Little Bit Culty. I think my episode with them is coming out this week, actually, so I'm kind of excited about that. Any listeners to A Little Bit Culty here? A few of you? Okay. Sarah and Nippy are also, they're the parents of two beautiful children, and Sarah and Nippy both star on a really epic, amazing nine-part series on HBO called The Vow. Have any of you seen The Vow? I promise you that you will want to see The Vow. And season one is already out, season two is coming out. But most importantly, Margie and I have been able to spend some time with Sarah and Nippy just over the past few days. And I, both through The Vow and through just spending time with them, am just thunderstruck in awe of the wisdom and the strength and the heart that both Sarah and Nippy have. If any of you guys know about Keith Raniere and the NXIVM cult, Keith Raniere is, he founded his cult in upstate New York. He started out as, kind of a fraud in another area. And then after his fraud went south, he then started a new kind of spiritual movement in upstate New York. And while in upstate New York, he pulled together, I don't know how else to say it, a polygamist female sort of insider group. He created levels within his organization that were secret. And ultimately, his polygamous sex cult in upstate New York was taken down. And he now ended up in prison. And it's one thing to survive being in a harmful, high-demand religion or cult. And I think everyone's comfortable saying NXIVM is a cult. It's one thing to escape a cult. It's a totally different thing entirely to bring that cult down and to bring their leader down. And that's what Sarah and Nippy helped do. And so I give to you guys Sarah Edmondson, everybody. Let's give her a welcome, Utah. Mormon and post-Mormon welcome.
Thank you, John. Okay, that was like half of my talk he just told you, but that's okay. Repetition for emphasis. One of the earlier questions was who had to lie to get here, and I was one of those people. I wish you could have seen the border guard's face when he said, "So what's the purpose of your trip?" I'm going to speak to some ex-Mormons at a convention. They do that? I guess so. I don't know. What do you do? It's my first time. Ah, and what's your final destination? Salt Lake. Oh, you're going back to Utah? I didn't have the heart to tell him that I wasn't ex-Mormon. I just thought it would be easier to leave it there. So I'm not ex-Mormon. But I am here because of a slide. Joel, will you put that slide up for me? October 17th, 2017. Is it there? No, that's not the right slide. Never mind. It was a picture of me on the New York Times. The front page. Okay, there it is. Yeah, that was just the beginning. After that, there was this CBC podcast called Escaping Nexium. Not my podcast, someone else's. Had over 25 million downloads. And then the HBO docuseries, The Vow, which I think some of you have seen. And literally hundreds of interviews, and then my memoir. So my story's out there. In gritty, raw, very, very personal, vulnerable detail. But that's not why I'm here today. I'm here to talk about what happens after your story is out there, when it goes to press. How do you get out and how do you heal? But of course, every journey like this does have a backstory, so I'll just try to give you some of the cliff notes, bring you up to speed, and explain to you how I got into this company called Nexium, which was supposed to be a personal and professional development program, how I escaped, and how I'm doing today. Sound like a plan? Okay. So I was this like stereotypical aspiring actress in my 20s, living in the proverbial basement suite, doing auditions, looking for meaning, purpose, community. And I just so happened to meet this filmmaker who made a film that I really respected. It was called What the Bleep Do We Know? And he said to me, if you liked my film, you may like this workshop that I just did. And I didn't research it, didn't Google it. I just said, sounds great, sign me up, because I trusted him. And my first 5-day training was kind of like this bizarre mixture of really helpful tools for life hacks, and also bizarre rituals. Like the speaker before me, rituals are important, but they also can be weird. And overall, on day one, I had this feeling that something wasn't right, and I Googled it after I came home that day, and there was some nasty things to be said about Nexium. Not like there is now, but there was enough for me to call Mark, the director of What the Bleep, and say, what the F did you get me into? And he said, do you believe everything that's on the internet? Anyone can write anything about anyone, about anything, anytime. Do you believe that, or are you going to trust your own experience, not what someone who's never even taken our curriculum has to say? Trust your experience. Wait till day 3. And I did, partly because I couldn't get my money back. I'd spent $2,000 to attend a 5-day training, and I waited it out. Day 3, I had some huge shifts, and by day 5, I was a true believer. I felt like I had this veil lifted off of me, and I had this clarity that I've never had up until that point in my life. I felt like I'd been given this secret handbook that no one else had, that was tools for life, how to live your best life, hashtag all the things. And I also knew, or I felt at the time, that if everybody in the world had these tools, that they would have more honor, more integrity, more joy. And if world leaders were to have these tools, they would communicate and get along and not bomb each other, and there would be war no more. Hashtag idealist. So, to summarize the next 12 years of my time in Nexium, I took more classes, I became a coach, took some more classes, and I followed the company's ladder of ranking system that promised future enlightenment and measurable growth. And if I just stuck to the path, I would have all the things I wanted: joy, prosperity, success, meaning, purpose. And I did that. I brought Nexium to Canada, opening the very first center in my hometown of Vancouver, but also traveled to Mexico and to the US on missions to help other people have the same transformational experience that I had had. It was everything to me. It was my community, it was a new way of living, and there were some really wonderful things about my experience. But as you can imagine, it wasn't all peaches and cream. There were a lot of doubts that I had over my 12 years there. A lot of red flags that I couldn't wrap my head around at the time. Just things that left me feeling a little uneasy. Just certain inconsistencies. Like, we were supposed to be building humanity and community, but we were really righteous towards anyone who wasn't doing what we were doing. Sound familiar? We were also supposed to be dedicated to critical thinking and inquiry, but we weren't allowed to look at anything negative that was said about our community. In fact, we weren't really encouraged to express anything negative at all, because that would mean the tools didn't work. So there was this sense of toxic positivity that looked like, how are you? I'm good. I'm so good. How are you? I think you relate to that one. I realized that none of this was actually a healthy doctrine, but it was a slow burn indoctrination into the leader's worldview, a man named Keith Raniere, as John mentioned. And all of these things I saw and I felt, but I couldn't quite wrap my head around it. And it was like I would put every incident, every observation on a metaphorical shelf. I've heard you guys use this metaphor too. I did it as well. I'm not copying you, I swear. I had the shelf. How the company's operating. Why I was putting in so many hours and not getting paid. The toxic positivity. All the inconsistency, the double standards. For example, in one particular training, if you were late, let's say 15 minutes to a training, perhaps even this size, everyone would be standing military style in silence, waiting for you until you showed up. And then you'd all have to wait together for the same amount of time that they'd already been waiting. Just shaming you to make sure you learned your lesson. But the leaders were late all the time. They didn't have to do the stand and shame thing. Didn't make sense. Hashtag double standard. Now, I wish that I'd gone to somebody outside of my community with these concerns. But that's not how it works, right? You got to go to your leader, your upline, your sponsor, your coach. And so I did. And if I ever expressed these concerns, it was always flipped back on me as my issue, my fears, my unresolved, in Nexium we called it disintegrations. It was clearly a fear that I hadn't resolved yet, and I was always trained to make it think it was my problem, and I was trained to doubt my doubts. A phenomenon I would later learn was called gaslighting. Do you guys know why it's called gaslighting? Does anyone not know? Just, it's okay, put your hand up if you don't know. Okay, there's enough people, I'm gonna just tell this really quick. It's called gaslighting because there was a play and a movie where there was this awful sociopathic man who wanted to make his wife feel crazy and doubt her reality. So when she was reading, he would turn down the light on the gas lights so that she couldn't read, and he was like, what's wrong with you? I can read. So she started to doubt her reality, and that's the nature of where the term gaslighting comes from. So I felt off during this time, and I couldn't place myself into reality because I didn't understand what was being done to me. Needless to say, that shelf got so heavy. Got so heavy, and it couldn't hold anymore until I eventually realized that everything that I learned was actually based on a web of lies. See, I had started to stray from the flock a couple years before I left because I had a baby, my priorities were shifting a little, and I think the organization had a sense of that, so they offered me an opportunity to kind of double down, and they invited me to join into a secret society for women, mostly made up of people in the community, my close friends, and this sisterhood would be immortalized by a sacred ceremony where I would be getting a tattoo. Or so I thought. Now, I have to be totally honest with you guys. I took this part in and out of this talk because I didn't want to alienate you, as this is very violent and a very destructive thing that happened in our group. But it's important to know that I was surprised on the night of the ceremony, and it wasn't a tattoo. It was, in fact, a branding. And if you're not sure what that means, it's like what farmers do to cattle. But I had been blackmailed to follow through on my commitments. It was too late for me to leave, and these details are very complicated to explain in a speech, which is why I wrote a book and why I agreed to do the vow. Interestingly, the act of branding itself wasn't enough to wake me up. It was realizing weeks later that the symbol on my body, right here, was not a symbol for the four elements, as I'd been told, but was in fact a cryptic monogram of the leader's initials, Keith Raniere, on my pelvis. Yeah. And that disgusting, desperate, deceptive attempt for him to lock down loyalty because people were leaving was what caused me to decide to leave the group, become a whistleblower, go to the authorities, and then eventually the New York Times. But I was still piecing it together. I couldn't even wrap my head around how I'd gotten there, from this aspiring actress to having a man's initials and not my husband's seared into my flesh. I realized, and I'd heard negative things over the years, I realized that wasn't blasphemy. It wasn't a smear campaign. It was all true, and it was happening to me. That moment when I figured that out, everyone who'd ever said, I think you're in a cult, they were right. And the rug just got ripped out from under my feet, and my whole world came crashing down when I realized that everything I'd learned in that 12 years was based on lies, based on a con. Keith wasn't who he said he was. He wasn't the smartest man in the world with an IQ of 240. He wasn't one of the top three problem solvers. He wasn't the world's biggest humanitarian and ethical leader. He may have been an East Coast judo champion at age 11. I'll give him that. Everything else was BS. Why had I never checked his credentials? Why had I never looked him up? It was all made up. But the worst lie was he's not a celibate monk, as I had been told. If anyone doesn't know what the word celibate means, it means to not engage in sex. No. Keith Raniere, as John said, was just a simple man from upstate New York with a sketchy criminal history who wanted to start a really beautiful community and also have a harem of spiritual wives. Sometimes it's so clear when you see it in someone else's group, isn't it? I realized he did not have the godlike authority that I had given him on that pedestal. People used to always say, Keith says. Someone even told me once that Keith said, I only need 600 calories a day. I was like, what is he, a nutritionist now? Hashtag red flag. I realized this was not a healthy community. It was a self-sealing system with no accountability and no room for personal opinion. And that's when I figured out I was in a cult. And I know that word is really loaded. I even checked with John and Clint, like, can I say cult? Like, I don't wanna, we can call it a high demand group. Is that better? Or an organization that uses undue influence. Same stuff. Either way, I was out, I was done. And because we went to the New York Times, the Eastern District of the New York State called it a criminal organization and put Keith Raniere behind bars for 120 years. Mm-hmm. hashtag justice. That's the good news. And that's the backstory. Okay, so once you get to that point, when you recognize the lies, you recognize the con, and you want to move on, how do you heal? And I just want to share today what's worked for me, with the caveat that it's such a personal journey and you have to find the things that work for you. So the first thing for me is that I had to make sure that I was safe. I put extra locks on my doors. I was highly paranoid in the first few months. But I also had to take care of myself. And for me, that looked like, and I'm gonna give you very tangible things if you're still in the kind of trauma of like, I was betrayed, if you feel that way. And I know we're all in different stages here. But for me, that looked like hot Epsom salt baths, eating really grounding food, going for walks in nature. I had to learn how to just veg out and step away from the high demand hustle culture that was so much part of NXIVM. I'm still learning to do that, right, babe? He's like, you can just sit on the couch. I'm like, no, I've got to save the world again. Then I had to educate myself. I had to learn how high demand groups use coercive control. Thankfully, we are in the golden age of cult awareness. Who here has seen Wild Wild Country? Yes? Going Clear? Holy Hell? The Vow? These are all great documentaries. I have an incredible list of resources that I've put together in combination with people who left before me. It's on my website, sarahedmondson.com/resources. It's all there. And I also needed to find a good trauma therapist, not just any therapist, because not all therapists are trained to deal with us, people recovering from these kind of groups. They don't know what they're looking at if they're not trained properly. And you really want to find someone and interview someone until you feel comfortable, and someone who has the credentials. I now have a team of therapists. And someone who's able to deprogram you from everything you learned in your high demand group. And I got so many nuggets, so many things that I wish that I could give to you right now. But one of the things that really helped me when I first got out is that I was just so devastated because I couldn't save everybody. When Nippy and the other whistleblowers and I left NXIVM, we brought thousands of people with us. But a couple hundred, and maybe now to this day, even 50 remain. And these are people who are at our wedding, people I love dearly, and they shun me. They won't speak to me, not even to say goodbye, and that was really painful. But my therapist helped me understand that there is a ranking system where people will always choose the loyalty to the leadership over any personal relationship while they're still in. And that, just that simple understanding helped me feel less pained by that rupture, that it wasn't so personal. It was what they needed to do until they had their moment of waking up. And also, finding someone who holds space for you in a positive way. I remember the first time I spoke to actually wasn't even my therapist, just happened to be a therapist, and Dr. Matthew Steinfeld, and I said, sort of briefly, my story, and he looked at me and said, wow, that sounds really awful. I'm so sorry you went through that. And I had a huge awareness just right then, because anytime I brought anything to my leadership or my coach to work through something, it was always flipped back on me like, well, how'd you cause yourself to be there? What's missing in you that you need anything to be different? Or you seem really reactive. You need to go work on that. Go journal on it. Go sit with that. So I always felt like anything that happened in my life was my fault. Now, of course, I'd made decisions to get myself to that place, but I was also lied to, and I was betrayed. And having him hold space for me just to feel, yeah, that was really awful, was very important, and I encourage you to find a therapist who can do that for you, too. 4, creating support and healthy community. Look, you guys are doing it. This is amazing. The ex-members of NXIVM are not this big. Most of them want to hide under a rock because they're so ashamed. But the first time we got together after leaving was so cathartic because we were able to speak freely and to share how we really felt without the fear of getting punished. And I remember talking about Nancy, who is Keith Raniere's right-hand woman, who I also at one point revered as my bonus mom, but could also be really mean. One time I got in trouble for bringing too many gluten-free Canadians to her training. Like, rice crackers are gonna break the budget, but she like shamed me for that publicly. And once I got in trouble for not paying her enough tribute at an event very similar to this in a ballroom, I was introducing her and I wasn't gushing enough, apparently, and I got in trouble for that too. So to say, you know what? Nancy's kind of a biatch. She is. That felt so good. You can do it too. I give you permission. So good for you guys for creating that community. And part of that was reclaiming my time and reclaiming my values and learning what was important to me and not an outside source. I had to learn how to make myself an authority on me again. And that took a lot of time. And the first thing that happened is I went through my calendar and cleared all of the reoccurring standing events in my iCal. I'm talking like 25 hours a week of conference calls. Proctor calls, senior proctor calls, coaching calls, goals calls, committee calls, executive board meeting calls. I mean, the list went on. And then all of a sudden, I had an empty schedule. And I didn't know what to do with it. I had to figure out what I liked again. And my husband and my family and I had to create new family traditions like Saturday pancakes and farmers markets and walks in the woods, a term that I think you all call second Saturdays. I like that. I kind of feel like my whole life is a second Saturday right now, because I just do what I want to do. It's not for anybody else, including being here. I also had to learn how to deal with emotions, because NXIVM taught us to not feel our feelings. If you were feeling low, all you had to do, and this is their term, state change. Just change your state. It wasn't healthy. So when I got out, I had anger, fear, betrayal, shame. How do you deal with this stuff? For me, going public is how I had to face my shame head on. Eat my humble pie, expose it, own it, and try to help others not make the same mistakes. For me. Writing, creative writing, and the eventual writing of my memoir was how I worked through some of the anger. And learning to forgive others. And I'm not saying forgiveness like making their behavior okay, but just not holding that anger in my heart anymore. And it's taken 4 years. It's taken a long time, but I can truthfully say I'm not angry towards any of the people that hurt me. But mostly I think it's forgiving, for me anyway, forgiving myself. For missing the red flags, for bringing in so many people, and for joining in the first place so naively. All of this to say is those six steps I mentioned, it all takes time. To summarize, a combination of self-care, education, good therapy, nature, writing, and for me also a non-culty yoga practice. And there was one other thing that I'd cut out of the speech because my mom told me to. But Bill earlier mentioned it, so I just also want to make a plug for legal microdosing of psilocybin. For me. And hey, whatever floats your boat, but for me, I wasn't doing it to get high, which I've done other times, but it was really, truly just to help me with the anxiety. And I take some tea and I go for a walk in the woods and it's just a good. So, sorry, Mom. Put that back in. And all of this can be found in that slide that was up earlier from my favorite book, Take Back Your Life. Who's read Take Back Your Life by Yanya Lalich? You guys haven't read that? This is like such a good book. In fact, it was such a good book when I read it, but when I first got out, I don't know about you guys, I had trouble like reading anything. I was just so out of it. And I said to Yanya, because we became friends, I said, can you let me narrate your book? I do voiceover when I'm not doing like cult-related stuff. And I begged her to let me narrate it. So if you get the book, it's me narrating, telling you how to get back your life. So do that. And she has lots of wonderful resources like John does. Her site is takebackyourliferecover.com, and she has workshops for all of the things I just mentioned. For me also, advocacy has been really important. I'm part of the hashtag #IGotOut movement. For those of you who are so kind to let me sign your book, I signed the hashtag. It's a healthy community of survivors, experts, and whistleblowers who are unified by that hashtag. People who want to, who are united by the hashtag and our passion for promoting, healing, exposing abuses of power by encouraging people to tell and share their stories. So that's what that hashtag is about. And I'm also an advocate on the microphone, like here today, and with my handsome husband and co-host on A Little Bit Culty, our podcast, where every week we sit down with experts, survivors, whistleblowers, and we just try to kick the doors down on that shame so that people have the roadmap and the templates for what these things look like so they don't get involved in the first place, and a roadmap out if they have found themselves in a cult or a high-demand group. So, all in all, oh no, my cards are out of order, which means I'm going to have to wing it. That's okay. I think I remember. All I was going to say was that New York Times article was 4 years ago, and I think I'm doing pretty good. I think I'm doing well. But two beautiful boys, an incredibly supportive husband who I did meet in Nexium, so hashtag silver linings, hashtag thriving. And I just want you to know that it takes a lot of courage to face your whole worldview, and it doesn't happen overnight that you can just replace it. It takes time, takes healing, takes support, all the things that you're doing here. And I just want you to know that if you're feeling nervous about that journey, breathe, go for a long walk, take care of yourself, and know that you're not alone and that you too can take back your life. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, stay up here.
We're going to take a few minutes. This is your mic. I totally forgot.
Sara Edmondson, everybody.
I forgot that I was staying. I was like, okay, I'm done.
So can we do a little bit of consent?
Yeah.
We believe in informed consent in this community. Do you mind if we ask you just a few quick questions?
I already agreed to that. I'm happy to.
Okay.
Ask me anything, honestly. You can't offend me with... And no, I did not have sex with Keith, just to get that out of the way. Yeah.
Okay, I'll scratch that question off.
He tried to get me, but that was a silver lining. Because if you've seen him, he's a bit of a garden gnome. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Look at my husband.
I mean, what was he thinking?
Nippy, would you stand up for everybody to kind of get Nippy?
This is my cowboy in the front row. Thanks, babe.
We were super honored, Karen and I and Gerardo and Margie were super honored to have you and Nippy on Mormon Stories podcast yesterday. And we got to hear 3.5 hours of their amazing story. And Nippy has his own amazing story. Nippy, he was a quarterback for Brown University. He's got an amazing story. His dad was born in Ogden, Utah. So Nippy actually comes from a Mormon background.
He's here to heal too. He just didn't know it.
And Nippy was fun to... What was that?
He's here to heal too. He just didn't know.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Nippy, it was so fun to go to a Jazz game with you yesterday as well. Sorry the Jazz didn't do quite as well as we wanted.
That's okay.
What's that? They come back? Yeah. Yeah. It was close. All right. Well...
Oh, can I just say also that John's going to be on A Little Bit Culty, and it drops tomorrow.
Yeah.
And it's a great interview. He's just... Sean, and I'm sure you're all going to love that.
Yeah. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you for coming on.
I do want to kind of address a tiny elephant that may be in the room for some. We started Thrive today by saying we wanted to make Thrive safe for believers and believing family members as best as we could. And I am sure that for those believers in the audience, to have us invite a cult survivor up and to even use the term cult probably feels very uncomfortable and probably offensive. And I just want you to know that we really struggled with this decision, but we decided to carry forward for one really important reason. It's not to be offensive. It's not to accuse the Mormon Church of being a cult. It is because, by any definition, I think by the church's own definition, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is a high-demand religion. It just is. And so whether or not, however you choose to describe the Mormon Church, trying to leave it, there are just so many similarities between it. And honestly, an objective look at history shows that there are parallels between Keith Raniere and Joseph Smith. And so I want to apologize for anyone who feels offended or hurt by even the association. And I would just ask you to please try and have an open mind and open heart. Know that we don't do this with an intent to be offensive, but because we are trying to help all these people in the audience and all the people who will watch this later. We're trying to help them with their journey because they experience it in very similar ways and probably in some different ways. Do you have any thoughts or comments about for the believers in the audience?
Sure, yeah. I think this is something that actually Nippy and I struggle with on our podcast. We're, even though it says a little bit culty in the title, we're not here to say what's a cult or not a cult. We're looking at what are the processes that are abusive in whatever group you're in, and do you like it? Because if you don't, you don't have to stay in it. And I know that's hard when your whole life and your whole community is there. And trust me, we had our own version of that. And I think for you all, it's times 100, 1,000, I don't even know. But that's just a tool set for you to say, okay, if it's a cult, a high demand group, whatever it is, what are they doing in that group that's not okay? And do I want to be a part of that anymore? It doesn't matter what you call it. And in some ways, the word cult is not good because it washes over in a very negative way, and it doesn't say what's bad. It just goes, oh, it's a cult. But like, what's bad about it? And then you can figure that out. There's a list of things that a high demand group does. And we've talked about a lot of those things today, the isolation, the us versus them, a leader with no accountability. Those things that I wove into my speech, those are things that are very tangible and verifiable by others. There's not this sort of like, oh, it's just a cult. Like, what is that? It's things that people do that are bad. That helps.
That's very useful. Luna Corbden is here. Luna has a book called Recovering Agency. Luna will be providing that book. And it basically lists 31 techniques of coercive or high demand groups. And we really recommend that book, along with your book, Scarred, of course. Anyway, here's the deal. For those of you who are believers or here, who are being such good sports, I'm going to challenge your spouses to make sure and attend general conference with you the next time it's held. And that'll be your payment for them coming here today.
Totally fair. But I'm never going to do Nexium again. Also why I didn't participate in the 20-minute breakout group, because we had a lot of breakout groups in Nexium, so I didn't. Oh, that's another thing I'd add to my list. Know your triggers. I said to Margie, I was like, I can't do this. We did too many breakout groups in Nexium. I'm going to go to the bathroom. That's okay. You don't have to do anything you don't want to do. Right?
It's a good concept.
So that's my other piece of advice.
Couple quick questions. I want to talk about this idea of leaving a high-demand religion that was a patriarchy as a woman, and talk about what it's been like to contemplate your own empowerment as a woman, and anything else that you've learned about your womanhood having escaped what was a toxic patriarchy.
Sure. I just realized, am I standing in the right place, or should I be over there? Or is this?
I think so. I think so.
It's
yeah.
Good.
We have to stand close enough for the shot, but I think the shot's
okay. Great. Well, it's ironic because the secret sisterhood that I had joined was designed, as I'd been told, to empower women, but it was actually to enslave them. And the details are in the vow and in my book. It's hard to explain what got me to that point, but I personally had to denounce that, leave everything that I was safe with and comfortable with, and say no to actually feel empowered. And Keith used to say, and I'm sure he stole this from someone wise, he used to say, character is not character unless it's tested. Otherwise, you're just waxing poetic. And after we got out and did everything that we did to expose him, we realized we tested our character. That was a really hard thing to do. And I felt empowered. So in many ways, I did get the empowerment that he promised, but not in the way he wanted. And I think that's really, really beautiful, at least for me, that was part of my journey. But it's also a strange time. The whole story came on the heels of the hashtag MeToo movement, and I felt like had this happened even 10 years ago, it may not have been supported or believed or dealt with in the same way. So it's a different era for women telling their stories, for being believed, for not being victimized. You know, the equivalent of like, well, you were wearing a short skirt. You know, that doesn't happen anymore. And I think that's really important, and I feel very empowered to be a part of that tapestry right now.
Beautiful, thank you. One of the most enjoyable moments yesterday at the Jazz game, you and Nippy pulled out a photo of your kids and you showed us your two beautiful children. Well, actually, it was at lunch, actually. And I want to know how you think about what you and Nippy have accomplished leaving your cult in the context of having two children. And were your children in any way a trigger or a motivator for you to maybe wake up?
Yeah, I think I had Troy about 3 years before we left. And I think, although I wasn't conscious of it at the time, I felt he was more important than anything else in the community. And I wouldn't have been able to voice that, but it kind of redirected my focus. And, you know, as we were waking up, which happened very quickly, it was, you know, especially Nippy was like, we're getting out of here. We're taking our, at the time, one kid and separating ourselves. It was very much like, protect the family. They're not going to have anything to do with us. And then later it became, how are we going to tell them about this one day? Troy's 7 now, and he knows there is a bad man named Keith, and mommy and daddy went to the police, and now he's in jail. That's what he knows. And I think that's all he needs to know for right now, but when he's ready, we'll give him the book and hope he can understand that, you know, we had to do what we had to do. And hopefully he'll be proud, then they'll both be proud.
I'm curious, you experienced such a betrayal of trust. You talked about joining when Mark invited you. You just said, well, I trusted him, so I joined. And then you made all these dear friends. You gave your heart and soul and life to this organization that betrayed you. I think one of the two biggest things we have to struggle with, number one, is how to trust other people again. As we were contemplating, the Martins and I and our committee were contemplating inviting you, I'm thinking like they could, I mean, how could they ever trust any organization again to invite them to do anything? Because how do you know what's going on? How do you learn to trust others again? Do you have any tips on that?
Again, I think that's it just takes time. Learning to trust your own gut it's a process because there have been so many times, like I said in NXIVM, where I was like, that's not okay, and then I overwrote it because the community was so good or whatever. Some other thing was better than the bad feeling I had. So now when I have a bad feeling, I just listen to it. I don't need to consult my elders. And like when I met you and, you know, trusted my gut that you're a good person, and you know, I feel like I've been through the worst. What's the worst gonna happen? Is I'm gonna brand me? Like, what are you gonna do? Like, I'm okay.
I'm not messing with Nippy, that's all I can say.
No, that's why he wears a belt buckle, just so you know, people know not to mess with him. But no, I feel pretty bulletproof. Like, once you hit that kind of rock bottom, you know, nothing else can happen, and yeah. That's where I'm at. But like I say no to a lot of things.
Sure.
So here I am.
We're very glad you're here. Thank you for trusting
thank
us.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Last question I have. We talked about this on the podcast a tiny bit. It's not safe for everyone who is in a high demand religion or who leaves a high demand religion to speak out. And we honor and respect that. And having said that, I do hold a special place in my heart for people who do muster the courage and who have the privilege, frankly, to be able to speak out and raise their voice. Because one of the things I say on Mormon Stories podcast is that silence is the enabler and silence is the killer. And oftentimes it's silence that allows very unhealthy practices to persist. And so if you watch The Vow, you will all see that so many people tried to leave Nexium and were slandered and smeared and sued litigiously into oblivion. So it's one thing for you and Nippy and others to have the courage to wake up the intellect and the conscience and the awareness to wake up. It's another thing to actually have the courage to leave. And that's a monumental task in and of itself. But to take that extra step and to take the risk, during the interview with Mormon Stories, I learned, because in The Vow, it sort of starts the video recording of them right at the beginning of their exit, before they've ever even gone to the New York Times. And I was like, man, how did you get HBO to start filming you at the very beginning? And you said, that's not what happened. You guys just had the faith that somehow you were going to be successful, and you decided to raise your voice before you had any contracts, anyone was paying attention. It was a huge act of courage. And so how did you and Nippy gain the courage to raise your voices, knowing that there was so much risk involved? Because other people had been destroyed by doing similar things.
It's a great question. I mean, it wasn't our first response. The first response was to GTF out, right?
Ask your neighbor if you don't know what that acronym means. Ask the millennials in the audience or Gen Z. GTFO.
And then we realized that we had friends there and we didn't want to leave them in the trenches. And so the second step was to kind of covertly inform and get as many people out as we could while having the company still think that we were loyal. Because we had seen other people defect and we knew that if they knew what we knew, that would be in trouble. And we didn't want that. So we learned from that and we were quiet about it, getting people out. Eventually my cover was blown when somebody recorded a phone call where I was like, don't go to Albany. You need to see my brand. Don't go to Albany. And she had already been branded and was setting me up to show that I was a defector and that I was bad news. And so once that phone call happened, I was, you know, excommunicated and no one ever spoke to me again. So then we were like, okay, guys, gloves are off, and we were loud. We were, you know, we went to the New York Times. We knew that we had to throw a bigger punch, and that at this point it wasn't just about being safe, it was about bringing it down. And especially for me, because I had brought so many people to this beautiful community, and now these are people that were there under his wing, and I felt responsible for them. So when people say it's courageous, I try to own that, but I'm also like, it was the right thing to do. Like, this is what I had to do, and I did it. And it was hard, and we could have been sued. Claire Bronfman, one of the benefactors, did try to get me arrested in Vancouver. Didn't happen, because I didn't actually do anything illegal. But she tried, and it was a very, very scary time. But we were fueled by our desire to make things right and to expose the truth. And we had no idea what we were exposing. Like, we knew about the branding. So much more came out in the trial, and then, yeah, we looked pretty brave in retrospect, but it was just like a series of events that kind of rolled into each other that had to happen. Did that answer your question?
It's beautiful. It's okay. Beautiful. All right, yes, thank you.
How are we doing for time?
No, we're good.
Oh, good, oh, good.
All right, well, Sarah, it's been so lovely to have you in Salt Lake City. We're really honored.
Don't they get to ask a question? Oh, you're the Q&A.
I'm the Q&A, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I thought they get to ask a question.
Well, what we're going to do, let me just do a final announcement. So they have an amazing podcast called A Little Bit Culty, and I want everybody to pull out their phones, if you feel like it, and subscribe to your podcast.
That'd be great.
And do they have a way to support you on your podcast?
Not yet. I mean, just subscribing and listening is great. You can write a review. We don't have, like, a donation thing yet, but we're going to follow in your footsteps and learn from, like, the Joe Rogan of Mormon podcasts right here. It's amazing. We're on Instagram, A Little Bit Culty, Sarah Edmondson, Nippy Ames. And come say hi outside and let me know if this has been helpful in any way, because that's what fuels me.
All right. So, Nippy, will you stand up? And will everyone please give a warm Thrive Utah thank you to Sarah and Nippy Edmondson?
Thank you. You are all so amazing, and it's just been such an honor to be
here.
Keep
it going for Sarah.
Thank you.
John.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Sarah.